All rise. The Honorable Supreme Court of Georgia is now in session. Chief Justice Hugh Thompson presiding. You may be seated.
Merry Monday, everyone. What a day to come in the court. This is one of those days you're glad you have an indoor job. Well, we welcome each and every one of you to this session of the Georgia Supreme Court. We note that Justice Nydia is not physically present here today, but we were recording all of the arguments. He will participate fully in all the cases that will be argued. And we invite you to stay pretty close centered over the podium so that we can be sure to capture you on our film and on our microphone as well. I would like to introduce our clerk of court, Ms. T. Barnes. Many of you know her, who we're proud of, and her chief deputy, Ms. Thea Melton, who is also in attendance on us this morning. Thank you. We have two first-class Moses Little as part of our security, and two Dustin Starling, part of our security, and we thank you for attending on us as well.
S13G1812, Metropolitan Atlanta Rapid Transit Authority versus Michael G. Reed, Michael Bagley for appellant, Todd Major for appellee.
Thank you, sir.
We have some advice around to help you keep up with your own time, but you better respond. Proceed when ready.
Good morning. Thank you very much.
Well, thank both sides. It's been very helpful. Appreciate your audience. The parties may call this case.
S13G1793, the state versus Earnest Walker Sr., Daniel Bidler for appellant, Angela Coggins for appellate.
When he ran from the officer and threw the drugs from his pocket. This court is well aware of the three levels or three tiers that the police and citizen encounters for. There's the first tier, the first level, where an officer may approach and speak to a citizen on the street. Then there's the third tier on the other end, which is the actual arrest. And the court is very clear that that must be supported by probable cause. But it's important to note that in the middle, there's the intermediate level, which is the investigatory detention. And that's when an officer, having reasonable suspicion that a person may be involved, not actually is, but may be involved in illegal activity, can go up and briefly detain that individual, whether you want to call that a seizure or a detention, and ask them questions to either confirm or allay that officer's suspicion. In this case, the officer saw appellee Mr. Walker on school property after midnight while the officer was out looking for a suspect in a theft case. Let me be clear, the testimony was from the very beginning in this case, the motion to suppress hearing and in the trial, the officer was very clear that he approached appellee Mr. Walker in this case because he wanted to find out why he was out there and what he was doing on school property. He did so, he approached and began to attempt to question Mr. Walker. Mr. Walker, the record shows, was somewhat loud, yelling, did not directly answer the officer's questions. He put his hands in his pocket. The officer said, take your hands out of your pocket. Adelaide ran, he fled. In the California v. Adore case, the Supreme Court addressed essentially what is a, and they use the word, seizure. And noted that there are two types of seizures. There's actual physical restraint, and then there's a show of authority. We're not here to argue whether or not saying take your hands out of your pocket is a show of authority or not, because the Adore case is clear, along with the show of authority, for a seizure to occur, there must be submission to that authority. And in this case, there was no submission. In the Hadari case, the officer attempted to stop some individuals, some juveniles, and they ran from him. In this case, our officer attempted to approach and temporarily detain for purposes of investigation, find out why he was out there, and happily ran. And when he ran, as in the Hadari case, he threw the drugs that were in his pocket out. He abandoned them. And as in the Hadari case, he said, and I'll quote it, the narrow question before us is whether, with respect to a show of authority, a seizure occurs even though the subject is not yielded. We hold that it does not. What's significant is, in court appeals themselves, in the Gray case, they acknowledge the very same thing. Absent a submission of authority to a show of authority, there is no seizure. So when Mr. Walker, the appellee, ran and threw out the items from his pocket, he had not been seized or even detained, if you want to use that word. And the reason I'm using both the word detained and seized is because I want to focus on what's important in this case, is that this was an attempted investigatory detention, an attempted tier two stop. And that's important because what the Court of Appeals has done
has over this part.
Yes, sir.
At the point the officer asked him to take his hands out of his pocket, was the officer attempting to exercise his authority over that individual?
I think he was attempting to, yes. The key word is attempting. Because he wanted to find out why he was out there. What he was doing out there on that property, or whether he knew anything about the alleged theft that had been taking place that evening. So he said, take your hands out of your pocket because I want to talk to you. At that point, he ran.
Could an officer walk up to an individual on the street and tell that individual, take your hands out of your pocket?
Just blindly?
So on patrol, going down the street, somebody walking down the street. Could the officer go up to the person and say, take your hands out of your pocket?
If that officer has reasonable, articulable suspicion, that person may be involved in criminal activity. Again, I stress, he doesn't have to have the certainty or the confirmation, just the suspicion. And he has every right under the tier two level of terrorist progeny to go up and attempt to detain that individual in question. If he has reasonable suspicion.
What was the suspicion at that time?
It was clear in the record when the officer testified he wanted to find out what he was doing on the school property after midnight.
That's not illegal, is it?
It's illegal to be on school property. It was also loitering problem. He was attempting to not arrest him. He was just attempting to find out why he was there.
It's not illegal to be on school property after hours. It's illegal to be there without permission.
And he was, officer could not ascertain whether or not he had permission or not because Mr. Walker ran from him. That's what he was trying to do. He was trying to find out. And I think the problem the Court of Appeals has done is it's turned what is essentially a tier two investigatory detention into an arrest when he says take your hands out of your pockets. And that's not what happened.
Counsel, is it the state's position that it's tier one up until the moment that the officer said take your hands out of your pocket?
Well, that's one way to put it. It was clear from the officer's testimony that he was going up there to talk to him to investigate. He wasn't going up there to initiate just the how you doing conversation. He wanted to know why he was there.
Well, at what point did the officer make a show of authority? Because we've got to assess, to determine whether there's a seizure under Hodari, we've got to determine whether there is a yielding to a show of authority. So we need to understand what the show of authority was. Was it merely, did we only have a show of authority at the point when the officer said, take your hands out of your pocket, or was there an earlier show of authority?
I would think that the show of authority would be, take your hands out of your pocket.
But, and he didn't, and he ran off at that point.
Correct. The reason that this is important is because Hodari sets the standard by which a person has not been seized by a show of authority unless he submits. And this is to ensure that a legitimate suspect can be detained and investigated if there is reasonable articulable suspicion. And I'm going to get to that in a minute because I know that was the other question the court had. And Justice Finn has already sort of gone down that road with me. But the officer has every right to stop someone that they suspect may be involved in criminal activity. He doesn't know why Mr. Walker's on school property. Is he supposed to just let him go because he just doesn't have enough information? Or can he legitimately stop and begin asking him questions and say, hey, why are you here? What do you know about this theft? Why are you at this school? So there's opposition that there is no seizure because look at the cases in Hodari and in Gray, the Court of Appeals' own case. There's no authority, no submission, the person runs, and they abandon the contraband, that's...
Mr. Dillard, that's your argument, excuse me. Mr. Dillard, your argument would be, if you answer the A question, no, you don't really reach B, you know, right?
Well, that's my argument.
It's not seized, I mean, you know.
Yes, that's my argument. But I'm going to address B right. A because the court has asked it to. And I feel that really gets to the real problem of the ruling of the Court of Appeals. Because the Court of Appeals said that the officer did not have reasonable suspicion because he did not have the information that Mr. Walker was on the school property for an unlawful purpose or a lawful purpose. He didn't know why he was there and what he was doing out that night. And it is our position that in effect, does away with reasonable articulable suspicion and establishes that the officer must have known that Mr. Walker had committed a crime before he could even go up and ask him questions. And the purpose of the Tier 2 of investigatory detention is so an officer can begin to accumulate that information on his own to confirm or allay the suspicion. And had Mr. Walker been cooperative, and said, I'm just going home, this is where I live, this is my name, that might have allayed the officer's suspicion. But the fact is, he ran. And what was the reasonable articulable suspicion? The officer made it clear. He wanted to find out what he was doing out there after midnight. The officer was looking for a suspect in a theft case. And why was he on school property? Those are questions he had every right to ask. Just a brief detention could either confirm or allay those suspicions. But the Court of Appeals took it a step further In this case, implicit in the officer's stated basis for detaining Abilene is an assumption that he's trespassing on school property. That's what he was trying to find out when he went up there. What are you doing here? That's what he was trying to ask him. There was no immediate assumption, and so he just went up to arrest him. Officers, however, simply lacked enough information to elevate such an assumption to reasonable suspicion. He didn't need to. He was trying to find out why he was out there. What the Court of Appeals has done is now made, it's now saying the officer had to have confirmation about his suspicion before he could even begin to ask questions. And that anything he did prior to that, he was free to run and just flee. And that runs contrary to cases in the United States Supreme Court and in the Court of Appeals. In the problem that's created by this rule is an officer can now not stop and question someone who's standing on the side of the road over the body of an unconscious trooper, because that person may be there trying to help. And the officer doesn't know if he's there trying to help, and that person can just run away. A person running from a bank with big bags of money, that officer cannot stop them and question them, hey, what are you doing with that? Because he doesn't have the information that this person might have been in there making a withdrawal at the time. Now, I know that sounds a bit absurd and ludicrous, but that's the standard that the Court of Appeals now requires an officer to have before it can make a tier two detention. Specifically, there's no evidence that the officer had any information that Kelly was present on school property without the consent of the school for an unlawful purpose, after receiving notice from the school that his presence was forbidden, after receiving notice from the school to depart, or without a legitimate cause to be there. That's what he was trying to find out.
Counsel, is there any evidence in the record that it was unusual to see persons on the school grounds after hours?
There was no empirical testimony or evidence to that effect. Based simply on the officer seeing him there and wanting to know why he's there after hours.
The problem, it seems to me, is that it is fairly unusual, I would suspect, to see anybody other than a bank robber come running out of a bank with a mask on, a gun in their hand, and a bag of money. On the other hand, it may or may not be unusual to see people walking across the grounds of a public school that's located in a neighborhood after hours. It seems to me, at least, I can't conclude just from common sense that only trespassers would be doing that. So it seems to me that you might have some evidence in the record that would have been helpful to the state, to have some testimony that it was unusual to see persons about legitimate business on school grounds after hours.
Well, this officer did testify that, you know, wanted to know if he was loitering there, prowling there. Why was he there? I understand your question about, you know, is this unusual, but the issue is it's after midnight. Officer's investigating, looking for a suspect in the theft case, see someone that is, you know, matches that description, doesn't match it to a T, but matches the description. Wants to know, what's he doing out here and why is he on that school property? I'm gonna go question.
What was the proximity between the theft that they were looking into and the school property?
It's my understanding it was in the same area, same neighborhood area.
What does that mean? 3 blocks away, right next door?
Walking distance.
Still not sure I understand what that means.
It wasn't all the way across town or in another subdivision. It was, you know, a quarter mile, half a mile perhaps. That's my understanding. I don't know if that was in the record or not. That was my understanding of it. Bottom line is that an officer under a tier two investigative detention situation, seeing someone that they believe may be involved in some sort of criminal or mischief activity, go up and briefly detain and say, hey, why are you here? What are you here for?
And also, he had some indication about clothing, the suspect, the previous motorcycle.
Yes.
Did this individual, was present the same way that suspect was described?
I believe Ms. Carter is going to probably be a better answer to that, but my understanding is he didn't match the description to a T. I think the clothing, part of the clothing was lighter than what was described, I think it was the trousers. But generally, the testimony from the officer from the start was clear. Was, I saw this guy and I wanted to find out why he was out there. And so he didn't say, I thought he's the guy that did it. That's the purpose of the tier two investigatory stop, to be able to detain him, briefly and question him to find out, hey, what do you know about this? But not, did you do it? Come with me. Any of that. Just, hey, we're looking for a guy. You're out here at midnight on this property, not before the morning, not before the afternoon after school, but after midnight. What is going on? Why are you here?
The thing that concerns me about this case is you start out with the proposition that citizens are entitled to walk in their neighborhood daytime, nighttime, anytime. Most of the neighborhoods in my county have schools in the middle of it. It is not unusual to see my neighbors walking around at that school morning, noon, and night. They're riding their bicycles morning, noon, and night. They're walking their dogs morning, noon, and night. Now, it seems to be your position is that if some crime has been committed, then an officer is entitled to go up to anybody walking in that neighborhood and ask them to take their hands out of their pocket or whatever.
No, sir. I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is if an officer has a reasonable articulable suspicion that a person may be involved in criminal activity, not definitely involved, not all the information, but may be involved, they have the right under Terry to go up and say, hey, let me ask you some questions. Can you take your hands out of your pocket? Just want to know why you're here.
Well, that's why I gave the scenario of the neighborhood where people are walking in school, in the school property, all times of day and night. Is there articulable suspicion?
Yes, sir, because it's against the law to be on school property without permission, especially at that hour of the night when it's mischief-making hour. The officer has every right to say, hey, why are you here? And if I may, I know it's just pretty, but if I can conclude, the United States Supreme Court in Hensley recognized the same problem that's created by the Court of Appeals. Restraining police action until after probable cause is obtained will not only hinder the investigation, but might also enable the state to flee, or the suspect to flee in the interim to remain at large. And that's what we have here. An officer who's trying to make an investigatory stop, attempts to question the person and detain them. That person runs, that person wasn't seized. This court should apply the proper standard of reasonable articulable suspicion and reverse the Court of Appeals. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Good morning, Chief Justice Thompson. Good morning to each of you. I am Angie Coggins. I'm the Chief Assistant Public Defender in Houston County, and it is my honor and pleasure to be here on behalf of the appellee, Mr. Earnest Walker, Sr. The first thing that I would like to tell this court is that the Court of Appeals did not err when it reversed the trial court's denial of Mr. Walker's motion to suppress. I think it is very important for this court to know that Mr. Walker did not match the description of the suspect. The record was clear. The suspect in the unrelated theft call was a black male in dark clothing. I have for the record a blow up of the clothing that Mr. Walker was wearing the evening he was illegally seized and detained by Officer Adriance. As the court can see, it is a light blue cowboy's hoodie with a gray hood. The cowboy's insignia emblazoned on the front in silver, very light khaki pants that the officer described as almost white, and white tennis shoes. It's also important to note that Officer Adriance repeatedly testified, not only at the preliminary hearing at the motion to suppress and at trial, that he stopped Mr. Walker to see if he was a suspect in the theft case. The trial court ruled in its written order that Mr. Walker did not match the description of the suspect. Mr. Walker was indeed seized within the meaning of the Fourth Amendment by the time he threw down the cocaine. And he was seized at the moment the officer commanded him to take his hands from his pockets. I think it's very important, just as Ben noted, that the officer approached him and asked him. That's not at all what happened. The officer is very clear in his testimony at the motion to suppress, at the preliminary hearing, and at trial, that he commanded Mr. Walker to take his hands from his pockets. As you pointed out, many public elementary schools are within residential neighborhoods, and Pearl Stevens does indeed sit within a residential neighborhood, and it was established at trial that Mr. Walker lived in that neighborhood.
Counsel, in what respect did Mr. Walker yield to the command of the officer to take your hands out of your pockets?
He stopped walking. He engaged with the officer. He stopped what he was doing. And that is indeed a submission to the show of authority. It is not necessary that he comply according to the Court of Appeals and even the Supreme Court. It's not necessary that one comply with the command. It's necessary that one submit to the show of authority. When Officer Adriance saw Mr. Walker walking off school property, he didn't approach him and engage in any conversation. He immediately commanded Mr. Walker to take his hands from his pockets. And I think it is very important to note, and this court has recognized, it is not illegal to be on school property, no matter what the time of day. The statute that is mentioned by the Court of Appeals, 20-2-1180, was never argued by the state of Georgia. It was never mentioned. Loitering, the standard statute for loitering was never argued by the state. Criminal trespass was never argued by the state. In fact, Mr. Walker was never charged with any behaviors for having been on school property because it's not a crime to be on school property.
Counsel, you keep jumping to the reasonable suspicion, and I understand that because I think that's actually the better part of the case for you. But before you get there, there has to be a seizure.
And
so my question is, what was the duration of the encounter from the time the officer made a show of authority and said, take your hands out of your pocket, until Mr. Walker fled?
There's no testimony in the record as to the length of time the conversation that took place between Officer Adriance and my client consisted of the officer walking up to Mr. Walker, and important to note that Mr. Walker continued on his path. He made no further movements. He did not try to conceal himself from the officer. He simply was walking. Officer Adriance gets out of the car in full uniform, armed with a taser and a firearm, and commands Mr. Walker to take his hands from his pockets. Mr. Walker stops what he's doing, which is walking home, and replies, "Why are you messing with me? I'm just trying to get home." For a second time, Officer Adriance commands him to take his hands out of his pockets. Mr. Walker again says, "Man, I'm just trying to get home." And then the testimony is at that moment, Mr. Walker extricated himself from the situation. And the officer chased him and takes him and then ultimately arrests him.
What's your best case law for the proposition that that sort of very brief encounter can amount to a yielding to the authority of the officer?
There are several cases. The amicus brief actually cites, I believe it's a circuit court case, Morgan. And in Morgan, an officer approached the defendant and said, "Hold on," and the defendant momentarily paused and said something along the lines of, "What do you want with me?" and then took off. And in Morgan, the court held that even that momentary pause was enough to constitute a submission to the show of authority. And we have more than that here.
Of course, that was actually complying, albeit for just an instant, it was actually complying with the command of the officer. Whereas here we have no compliance with the actual command.
I don't disagree. He did not comply with the command to take his hands out of his pockets, but he did submit to the show of authority for what I would guess was some moments of time.
I'm hearing implied in your argument when you say there's a seizure or a detainment that was an improper seizure and improper detainment, am I right?
Yes, sir. Okay.
At what point did the officer exceed his authority?
At the moment he commanded Mr. Walker to take his hands from his pockets, it would have been a first tier. It would have been a...
So even if there's safety issues involved in the first tier?
There were no safety issues. The officer never presented any testimony. There's nothing...
Let me ask a question. Even if there are safety issues in the first tier encounter, that wouldn't raise the level to a detention, improper detention, by asking somebody to take their hands out of their pocket, would it?
If the officer has a reasonable articulable suspicion to believe that the person presently armed and dangerous, they could have that.
They have to have a real suspicion that that person might be armed. Not based on where it's night and it's just me and this person and he's got hands in his pocket.
It has to be based on the objective circumstances, and I believe Terry indicates that you have to have a reasonable belief that the person is presently armed and dangerous.
But it'd be proper to ask the person to take their hands out.
If you had the reasonable articulable suspicion. Now, keep in mind, Justice, there was no testimony that the suspect in the unrelated theft case was armed. There was no testimony that there had been gunshots fired that evening. There was no testimony in the record to provide any reasonable articulable suspicion to detain Mr. Walker. Some of the cases that we cite, in fact, indicate Office Hernandez Espino, which was just decided by the Court of Appeals in November of 2013, going all the way back to Banks in 1996, and the one Supreme Court case of Sams from 1995. In the most recent cases, Hernandez Espino, you have the officers providing a little bit more information. They testify that the person's in an area that's known for drug activity, or they've had calls from neighbors complaining about drug activity taking place. There's no testimony. That's what's key here, is nothing in the record suggests that the officer saw Mr. Walker do anything that appeared to be a criminal act.
And do you have to wait for a criminal act before you can encounter, or something that looks articulably suspicious?
Again, with the first-tier situation, Officer Adriance would have been well within his rights to approach Mr. Walker and begin asking him questions, but he did not do that. He escalated it immediately to a second-tier detention without reasonable articulable suspicion. Mr. Walker was not committing a crime. The officer did not charge Mr. Walker with a crime, and as this court has pointed out during the sex argument, being on school property after hours is not a crime.
Did he do anything to lay a foundation in terms of patrol this neighborhood regularly? People don't walk through this neighborhood at all. They don't walk through the school.
Did he
any kind of foundation to show that what this particular person was doing was anything out of the ordinary?
He did not, and in fact, he confirmed on cross-examination that people do use that area as a cut-through. That's what we call it, a cut-through, when you walk across public school grounds to get where you're going. There was absolutely no testimony provided by the state, by Officer Adriance, that he had any reasonable or particular suspicion that Mr. Walker was either committing or was about to commit a crime, which is what is required under Terry. In Hernandez Espino, which as I say was just issued in November of this year, the officer testifies that he's familiar with this neighborhood, he's familiar with an apartment complex, he knows that drugs are actually sold out of a particular apartment complex, and he sees Mr. Hernandez Espino come out from that apartment. He goes up to Mr. Espino, begins asking him questions along the lines of, do you live here? He replies, no, I don't. What are you doing here? I'm visiting a friend. Hernandez Espino could not provide the friend's name. And the officer in that case, again, gave a little bit more information than Officer Adriance provided in this case. Because in our case, Officer Adriance provided absolutely no testimony, no information that would support reasonable articulable suspicion. And in Hernandez Espino, the officer felt like Mr. Hernandez Espino was lying to him, and the knowledge that the officer had about the apartment complex and potential drug activity commands Mr. Espino, give me the drugs you just bought. And the Court of Appeals says, you can't do that. You gotta have a little bit more. And it's important in Hernandez Espino because what the Court of Appeals rules is that when the officer says, give me the drugs you just bought, he escalates the encounter, which was originally a first tier, to a second tier. And in determining whether a police citizen encounter constitutes a second tier, the board must answer whether, considering all the circumstances surrounding the encounter, the police conduct would have communicated to a reasonable person that the person was not free to decline the officer's request or otherwise terminate the encounter. And they go on to cite circumstances that might demonstrate a second tier encounter, include the use of language or tone of voice indicating compliance with the officer's request might be compelled. And they go on to cite several cases, including Brown, where in Brown, same situation, the officer commanded Mr. Brown to remove his hands from his pockets, bumped it from first tier to second tier. And they point out again that the officer's words were not a request that Mr. Hernandez Espino was free to ignore. It's clear that the officer's conduct and statement would have communicated to a reasonable person, and that's, of course, what is the standard. A reasonable person would have communicated to a reasonable person that that person was not free to decline the officer's request or otherwise terminate the encounter. And importantly, in Hernandez Espino, the court holds that whether an officer slash citizen encounter is first or second tier encounter is not governed by the citizen's willingness to comply with the officer, but is the command itself. I would argue to this court that just as in Hernandez Espino, where the court held that it was not a close case, they say we are not called to draw upon a close technical distinction. The officer's words were a command, and there is no evidence that they were anything other than a command. And the court goes on to say, but even if it were a close case, we would be called upon to draw, and we were called upon to draw a fine line, it would be our duty to draw such a line. And then they quote Terry. And that's what's important here. When we're talking about the Fourth Amendment, we're talking about people's right to be free to walk on school property at whatever hour. The right to play flag football games on school property. The right to use it as a cutthroat without being approached when you are committing no crime. You are engaged in no suspicious activity. You are simply walking through your neighborhood to get home. And the court said this, and this is quoting Terry, the scheme of the Fourth Amendment becomes meaningful only when it is assured that at some point the conduct of those charged with enforcing the laws can be subjected to the more detached, neutral scrutiny of a judge who must evaluate the reasonableness of a particular search or seizure in light of the particular circumstances. And in making that assessment, it is imperative that the facts be judged against an objective standard. This case, the Court of Appeals opinion in Walker, in no way negates or changes or elevates or confuses the standard that has been in place for years, dating back to Terry. We've had first tier, second tier, third tier. These guidelines have been in place and have been outlined for us for decades. And if this court were to reverse the Court of Appeals, you would necessarily have to reverse all the line of cases that have held exactly what the Court of Appeals held in Walker. You've got to have a reasonable articulable suspicion. In order to stop a citizen, an officer must possess more than a subjective, unparticularized suspicion or hunch. And that's what we have in this case. Officer Adriance was never able to articulate any suspicion of any criminal activity. The only comment that Officer Adriance could think to make is, what's he doing on school property after midnight? He's walking home. That's what he was doing. That is not a crime. The language in Hernandez Espino speaks to me, and I hope it speaks to this court. It is well established that mere presence in an area of suspected crime is not enough to support a reasonable, particularized suspicion that the person is committing a crime. Moreover, an officer's feeling that a person is acting in a suspicious way does not amount to a particularized and objective basis for suspecting him of criminal activity. And they cite the warning, which is not to a recent Court of Appeals case as well. Mr. Walker's presence in the neighborhood where theft crime had been called in Mr. Walker's presence in that neighborhood when he doesn't even meet the description. Mr. Walker's presence on school grounds, Mr. Walker's walking across school grounds, that in no way is enough to support a reasonable particularized suspicion that he was or was about to commit a crime. And each of you have, many of you have indicated and said it's not a crime to be on school property. That is clear. The language that speaks to me in Hernandez Espino is this sentence, and it follows the language regarding your presence in an area and somebody thinking you're acting suspicious does not amount to a particularized objective basis for suspecting one of criminal activity. This principle reflects a foundational decision to sacrifice a little safety to purchase liberty. In the Walker case, just as in Hernandez Espino, the facts testified to by the officer raised a subjective, unparticularized suspicion or hunch about Walker's reasons for being on school property, but they did not provide an objective manifestation that he was or was about to be engaged in criminal activity. And consequently, just as in Hernandez Espino, the second tier encounter was unlawful. In Walker, the second tier encounter was unlawful. And for those reasons, we would ask the court to affirm the Court of Appeals decision and leave in place the suppression of the evidence. Thank you.
Thank you. I believe we've got 6 seconds.
I'll donate that to the next case.
Thank you. All right. Well, I want to thank both sides. Before we call the next case, we made this announcement. Of course, we'll take about a 10-minute recess. And then 10 minutes, we'll be back into the last case.
All rise.
Yeah, that's fine.
I'm there, you don't have a convention.